Hi, everyone. In this lesson, we'll quickly introduce the AWS Global Infrastructure. We'll take a look at why a cloud service provider's infrastructure matters to us as customers and how that can influence our infrastructure design choices as cloud architects. For this quick intro, we'll just walk through the AWS Global Infrastructure page as our starting point and to help familiarize ourselves with the resource as a reference in the future. Now, certainly take some time to read through this on your own, but I do want to call out some specific areas to focus on. First, I want to point out the AWS claims here for their global infrastructure. AWS notes that they're the most secure, extensive, and reliable global cloud infrastructure. Now, when businesses are in the initial phases of evaluating which major cloud service provider to go with, there are many considerations to take into account, of course, but taking a detailed look at the global infrastructure capabilities of a cloud provider is an important first step to ensure they provide the regional availability capabilities and to meet the business needs of their customers. Now, AWS has five core components to its global infrastructure. We have regions, availability zones, edge locations, local zones, and wavelength zones. Now, don't worry about what all these mean quite yet. We'll dive into these in upcoming lessons. Remember that with this course structure, we're learning in layers, introducing new material, building up our understanding of how it relates to other information, then layer on more depth as we go. So as a quick preview of these core global infrastructure concepts, a region is the geographical area where AWS has data centers present that provide their services from. As a business, if I know I have customers or offices in Canada or India, I could leverage these AWS regions to deploy my applications in to offer lower latency connectivity and improve the end user experience. Then within each region, AWS has something called availability zones. For now, we can just basically think of an availability zone as a data center facility. AWS has multiple availability zones within each region to help its customers achieve their high availability objectives. So if there's a data center failure for some reason within that same region, the AWS services are still available. Now, you still need to design your AWS cloud environments and applications to take advantage of these availability zones properly, but we'll get into that later in the course. The other core concept to be aware of are edge locations. There's a lot more of these than region locations. And these are special AWS data center facilities that focus on caching data and network acceleration. These edge location points of presence can cache data so that it's closer to the end users that access it, or help get users accessing the AWS services onto the AWS backbone network of their super high bandwidth fiber links as quickly as possible. They offer a closer connection point to global users to access the AWS backbone network, helping them avoid the public internet as much as possible. And this reduces network latency when using AWS services and providing a better overall experience for the users. Local zones have a similar goal of the edge location points of presence. However, these local zones can run select core AWS services within them. As an example, you could have single-digit millisecond latency for end users of your applications in these local zone areas by running AWS compute or database services within them. Wavelength zones focus on optimized mobile edge computing. These wavelength zones are AWS facilities tied into 5G network service providers so that mobile device traffic is kept within the service provider's network to offer low latency access to select AWS services when they're accessed over 5G networks from phones and other mobile devices. Now, at the time of recording here, AWS has 33 regions today, 105 availability zones, and over 600 edge location points of presence. They also have 37 local zones and 29 wavelength zones. And all of this is providing various AWS services and network connectivity options across 245 countries and territories. Now, taking a look at the map here on this page, we can see the rough location of the core AWS regions today. The map is actually interactive, so you can hover over the different sort of region hotspots and get an overview of when the region was launched and the number of availability zones within it. All new AWS regions will have at least three availability zones within them. Now, if we take a look at the North Virginia region, we'll see this one actually has six availability zones within it. So that's it for a quick introduction on the AWS global infrastructure. Understanding this is really important before getting into the later lessons. So please take some time to read through the rest of the landing page here. And then try to answer the question of why does cloud infrastructure matter? Then summarize the 6 benefits of AWS Global Infrastructure into your own words. Again, don't worry too much about diving into the specifics of regions, availability zones, and the edge location stuff quite yet, as we'll get into those later on in the course really soon. So that's it for the lesson again. Thanks for watching and see you in the next one.